for your entire career. I frequently say that career in academic medicine is a marathon, not a sprint. Right. And if you know anything about marathons, you have to fuel yourself. You have to have periods of rest, walking periods, in addition to running periods, so that you can finish that marathon. And the same is true for us. We really need to have those foundational skills.
Welcome back to the Faculty Factory podcast. I'm Kim Skorupski, the Associate Dean for Faculty Development at Johns Hopkins. And today we're very happy that we've got Dr. Wendy Ward back. Hi, Wendy.
Hi.
Dr. Wendy Ward is a professor at the University of Arkansas for Medical Sciences, the Director of Interprofessional Faculty Development, and the Associate Director of Professional Wellness there. Her background is in clinical psychology and ped psych, I believe, right?
That's correct.
And Wendy has been developing these great 10 tips for early career professionals. Hopefully by now, you've not only listened to her interprofessional education talk, which was really cool, team-based care, like well-oiled team members. It was such a great talk, and I really urge you to go take a look at that. And she's already talked about 10 tips to prepare for promotion. What's on deck today, Wendy?
Well, I was thinking today we would talk about 10 things early career professionals can do to promote better work-life balance, or what's commonly referred to as professional wellness.
Okay, that's really important always and especially now. Please take it away.
Thank you. So items 1 through 7 are going to sound a little simplistic, but bear with me because sometimes those foundational concepts are super important. So the first thing to do is to start healthy habits early. So hopefully you've started those in your residency or your fellowship. But if not, starting off with building a schedule and a flow of your day that includes healthy habits can really help protect you from the stress that is commonly occurring in our healthcare system right now. So those healthy habits could include things like healthy eating. Now, I, like all of our listeners, have a very hectic work life. And so being able to sit and have a fully formed lunch that I create in the moment is really just impossible. So trying to find ways to eat healthy on the go or in small bits of time or while on conference calls or at meetings, a really important way to try and maintain physical health in your early career, and that will help sustain you throughout the rest of your career. There are lots of places you can find tips and tools for building those work lunches. It might be what you purchase and keep in your office. It might be batch cooking ahead of time. Lots of those things out there on the internet. I would really encourage you to go and take a look. The second, and very similar, is to have an active lifestyle. Now, I know my schedule has changed over the years, and so there were times that I was in clinic from 8 to 5, and so getting up early or going after work were my only options for when to do physical activity. But I spent some time thinking about where it fit best for me and where I was less likely to say no. I'm a morning person, so early in the morning is best for me. If I wait till the end of the day, I'm too fatigued. But I have friends and colleagues that it's the complete opposite. In fact, my husband is the opposite, so we rarely work out together. But doing it at a time where it fits with your own sort of internal likelihood that you're going to do it can really help in sustaining a lifetime exercise habit. And we know that exercise can improve physical and mental health. In fact, it's one of two huge, impactful things that you can do to promote better health and wellness. The other one is sleep, and I'd like to talk about that for a little while. Disrupted sleep is common. Many of us as healthcare providers work unusual shifts or are on call, and that creates a lot of sleep disruption, which we know has a cascading effect. In fact, not getting high quality and quantity of sleep can impact fatigue. It can impact the degree of medical errors that you might have. It impacts memory. It impacts emotional health. You're more likely to be depressed or anxious, worrying. It can have an impact on you physically, so it will increase the inflammation markers in your system, which can have a cascading effect on numerous health conditions. And so sleep, even though it's something we tend to put last really needs to be put first. Mm-hmm. And make sure that we're getting 7 to 8 good quality hours. And if our sleep is fragmented because of call, we might need more than that.
Right.
So add some extra hours for sleep. The fourth thing I would have people think about is time with important relationships. Oftentimes when we get busy, we drift away from the evening with our friends or the date night with our significant other or time with our children. And it isn't a conscious thing. It's just trying to be able to keep up with the requirements in a busy academic medicine career. And unfortunately, one of the best ways to support ourselves in stressful situations is really having those strong relationships, a strong supportive network of people to help us. And so I learned early on that having some time in my week that was quality time with each of my children and with my significant other helped sustain me on the days that I was stressed and maintain those relationships. Gave to them and also received nurturance back from all of those relationships to the betterment of their lives and mine as well. And so that's really one that I would strongly encourage people thinking about and doing. And it has changed over time. My kids and I, we used to do a night of the week and I would rotate who I would take out to dinner alone and kind of have that alone conversation with them where they open up about things that they won't in front of their siblings. And I really cherished that. And then we got so busy in after-school activities, we moved it to Sunday. So now it's a Sunday brunch that we rotate. So being flexible about the when and sticking with the it needs to be a high priority is something I would recommend to folks. My date night with my significant others moved around as well. So number 5 would be time management strategies. Now, that's a really interesting concept because we can't really find more time. It is a finite construct. We have the number of hours that we have. But utilizing our approach to time is really critical. So we want to make sure that we're blocking time in our day, not just the work day, but pre and post for these wellness activities that we're discussing and for other things that are truly important to us, things that are meaningful in our lives. Anytime we promote time with things that gain meaning. It helps reduce stress, promote that connection with the meaning in our life of the work and the things outside of work that we do that give us purpose. And so really thinking through what your schedule looks like, what you're protecting on your schedule, putting these wellness activities into your schedule, whether it's during the workday or before or after is really critical.
Yeah.
Number 6 is taking vacation and sick time. So I know that sounds really simplistic, yeah. But it is so important.
And I don't know anybody who does it.
Many of us don't. We end up working so much that we're not taking the time we need. Even healthcare professionals are working when they're ill. We know during the COVID-19 crisis that we really can't take the risk of infecting our patient populations and our colleagues. With any bugs that we might have. And so staying home when we're sick is critical. But it often feels to early career professionals like they're exhibiting weakness. And I would ask you to push back against that feeling because we really need to take the time to either renew, which would be vacation, or to become healthy again, which would be sick time. Now, I have a friend who uses an app that helps count down to the vacation time. There's actually some research on that. If you use an app and it'll text you now and again, you have 3 months till your vacation, you have 2 weeks till your vacation, but you can also look at the counter every day if you wish. The research suggests that that actually reduces stress. To know that you have a break coming helps you ride the stress that you're in much better. And so I've started using this app. There are a couple of different ones out there, and I'm blanking on the name, but I can pull it up pretty quick. But one of them is Countdown app here. Yep. Oh, they're all called Countdown. They're just different, made by different vendors.
That's so cool. I love it. I'd never heard of that.
Yeah, and it's a free app. You can only count down to one thing. So if you have multiple things you're counting down to, you can purchase it, or you can get 2 free apps and have 1 for each. The next one that I would think about is financial. There's a lot of emerging literature now on financial wellness with healthcare professionals. We are highly likely in our early career to have significant student debt. And it's really easy when you have a larger salary to engage you know, active lifestyle or a purchasing lifestyle that is consistent with your salary but not consistent with your debt profile. And so I would encourage you to think carefully before making big purchases like cars and houses and things like that, to really think about how to pay down your debt as a first priority, and then to enjoy some of the fruits of your labor, shall we say, with purchases after debt has been considered, and maybe after spending some time thinking about retirement planning, saving for student, your children or future children's college funds, those kinds of things, so that you have a lifestyle within your means and you're also preparing for those future financial needs, as well as dealing with any debt.
Yeah, so wise. Yeah. I love that advice. We on the podcast, we've had Dr. Yuval Bar-Or, who is from our Hopkins Carey School of Business, and he just did a podcast on financial, the essential financial basic like content for junior faculty members, and that's exactly what he talked about. But I like how you said that living, that the contrast between, how'd you put it so nicely, your salary versus your debt profile, the, what was it? Mm-hmm.
I can't remember the exact words, but
y'all heard it out there. But I think that's a really nice way of saying, you know, looking at the salary, but having that contrary to the debt profile. I thought that was a really interesting way of thinking about. Yeah, you may have the high salary, but you may have the high debt as well. So let's prioritize that.
Exactly. So as I mentioned at the start, items 1 through 7 are really foundational concepts. They're not new or earth-shattering. But they are critical to set a foundation of a healthy lifestyle across all those different domains. And they're critical not just as junior career faculty, but as you go through your career, stresses change, schedules change, being aware that those 7 items are a high priority and maintaining them as a priority in your lifestyle for your entire career. I frequently say that a career in academic medicine is a marathon, not a sprint. Right. And if you know anything about marathons, you have to fuel yourself. You have to have periods of rest, walking periods, in addition to running periods, so that you can finish that marathon. And the same is true for us. We really need to have those foundational skills. So number 8 really is thinking about times of stress. There are going to be times in our lives where stress is higher. If you're in the inpatient world, it's during flu season. If you're in the outpatient world, you have less stress during the summer. It tends to be a little lighter, particularly in pediatric world. If you're a researcher, then right before grants are due are going to be a really stressful time. If you're an educator, then those 9 months are more stressful than other periods of the year, and particularly around exams. So whatever track or specific area you're in, there are times of higher stress and times of lower stress. And I would have you think about, during those high stress times, what you can do for yourself. Planning ahead. You know it's coming. There are other things we don't perceive are coming. We're not aware they can't be prepared for. But there are some that you can. Do you need extra sleep during that time? Do you need more walks or exercise during that time? Do you need to think more strategically about what you're eating during that time, or spending more time with supportive people, or maybe a vacation right after is a good thing to plan? Those are things that you could really think about and prepare for ahead of time. I would similarly have you think about those times of relatively low stress. Now, we don't ever have or almost never have no stress, but relatively lower periods of stress. Those might be the times that you could capitalize on doing some writing or more scholarly work. It might be the time that you would meet with mentees and really engage in that work, which might be harder to do at different times of the year. You might engage in clinical innovation project planning, so trying to get a group together and thinking about quality improvement projects. Or it might be a time that you prep some of your teaching materials that you can later use in the year. But thinking about the rhythm of the work that we have over the year and capitalizing on the lower stress times and planning for the high stress times can be super important. And then item number 10 is to really just recognize that balance isn't achievable. I work with so many people who think that there's this harmony, this state of balance that you achieve And I will tell you that those moments are rare, and it doesn't mean that you're not balanced. In fact, the word balance might not be the best word to think about. Resilient. I think about ocean waves or things that ebb and flow, being able to roll with those changes and maintain an upbeat, positive attitude and to maintain your own physical and emotional health and your relationships with others are really the sign that you have achieved professional wellness. And so I would show yourself some kindness and not think that this harmonious balance is achievable. I would suggest to you that it's not.
Wendy, this was wonderful. I really appreciate you.
No problem. Happy to do it.
All right, everybody. Well, you've been listening to and learning from and being and inspired and encouraged by Dr. Wendy Ward, a professor at the University of Arkansas for Medical Sciences. We'll see you next time, Wendy. Thanks for tuning in to Faculty Factory Podcast. The mission of the Faculty Factory is to build and support a community of leaders in faculty development who share tools, resources, wisdom, and encouragement in service to our faculty members, schools, and institutions. We encourage you to go to facultyfactory.org to find out more, get in touch with me, ask me any questions. Maybe you want to be interviewed on the podcast. Thanks for tuning in to Faculty Factory Podcast. We'll see you next time. The Faculty Factory podcast and website is sponsored by the Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine Office of Faculty. For more information, visit facultyfactory.org.